The English racing Integra is probably one of the most recognised Integras in both drag racing and half-mile race events anywhere in the world. And we're here with Myles from English racing. The car's just run 208 mile an hour, a new personal record here at Airstrip Attack 2018. Myles, I just wanted to take some time and find out a little bit more about what makes this Integra so fast. So can you start basically with the development of the car from when you got it? What sort of steps did you take with it?
Yeah, so I grew up drag racing a lot of an Integra just like this in the Dominican Republic, where I spent about 6 years. And when I came here, I bought this car 100% stock, and it's just been a progression since then. I did your typical bolt-on, full bolt-on, you know, 185 wheel. Then I put a turbo kit on it and 280, and then like just went up from there. And it went from, you know, to that all the way to what it is today. And the biggest steps have been, like, you know, to me, ECU is like the biggest key on this car. Traction control, everything that it has is big. And I've done a lot of aero work on it too, which that helps. But I felt like as soon as I put the Dogbox and the ECU in it, the car just went so much faster. And it, you know, every safety I can put in on it is there. The fuel pressure, you know, coolant pressure, oil pressure fail safes. I mean, anything, Lambda fail safes, it's all there. EGT, it's all there.
Let's just come back and talk about that engine a little bit. Obviously, yeah. You've talked about the development. You started naturally aspirated, mm-hmm. went to a bolt-on turbo kit, yeah. and you're very far away from that right now. So let's talk about the base block. So it's based around a B18C block. Can you tell us what's done inside?
Yeah, so it's English Racing built, so we actually assemble at the shock. Actually, I assemble at the shock. So technically, I'm not a tech. I'm just the office guy. So
you're the one people ring up and talk to.
I have to know everything about all cars, and I'm pretty knowledgeable. So I built the whole engine with obviously the you know, my engine builder there, TJ, definitely pointed me in the right direction of what I need to do. He usually shows me the first thing, and I build it all. So it's a custom Wiseco piston, hard anodized. It's almost an 11-to-1 compression motor. CP Carrillo custom rods, the most expensive steel rod they've ever made for a Honda, they said. And it's a stock Integra Type R crank, actually, so they're a tiny bit heavier than a GSR. 84 and a half mil bore, and so it ends up being like a 1.956 liter engine.
Now, talk to us about that bore. Can I assume that you've at least sleeved it?
Yeah, it's a Golden Eagle sleeve block, yes.
So this is one of the big problems when you start making really big boost, really big power with the Honda engine, or most aluminium blocks in general. The factory sleeves are very thin, and they don't hold up. So the sleeving is essential, in your opinion?
Yeah, I'd say, I mean, if you don't have an iron sleeve of some sort or something, you're only going to be able to make so much power. I mean, once you get to the level of over 1,000 wheel, however you look at it, a four-cylinder is not that reliable. I mean, you can only do so much to keep them, but if you didn't have a sleeve block, you're definitely fighting it. Yeah, you're not going to do it.
In terms of the power level you're running here today at Airstrip Attack and the boost level you're using to achieve that, can you let us know where you're at?
Yeah, so that pass right there, fourth and fifth gear, were like 45 and a half pounds, and the last event I went to, which was at sea level, I ran 207, but that took 54 pounds to do it. The main difference is traction was really bad there, and then here, if you make the same power here, you're always going to go faster because of the air being thinner. The problem is making the power is always harder. So
I understand here, really, it is a catch-22.
Correct.
The air density right now, barometric air pressure, sitting around 80 kPa.
Yep.
Typically, we expect about 101 kPa at sea level. So we're 20 kPa down. It means it's that much harder for the engine to actually make power. But the benefit that a lot of people may overlook is that it's easier to push the car through the air. My understanding is that this really benefits the higher power cars running north of 200 mile an hour more than the lower power cars. Is that fair?
Yeah, to me, anything over like 180, 190, if you know it, it's definitely an advantage on that aero wise. I have some good data from a couple years ago when I was here with the aero I had then, the power I had then versus now, and everything I've done just shows that up here it definitely has a good 6-7 miles an hour more from the quarter mile to the half mile. And yeah, a lot of people do forget. They're like, oh, you know, because they're used to, you know, your naturally aspirated cars, that, you know, they're stuck with what you've got. You can't turn up the boost on a naturally aspirated car. So when you come up here, if you have turbo, if you're not maxed out at sea level, you'll go faster here every time.
What sort of turbo are you using to create that boost pressure?
Yeah, it's a Precision 7675 Gen 2.
And boost control?
It's got two Mac three-port, or I guess you'd call them Mac three-port boost controllers. Right now, it has 6.5-pound springs in the gates. Unfortunately, the design of everything, it creeps to 38-30 pounds.
So you're running twin extended wastegates?
Yeah, I have twin 44 mil gates, but it won't run any less than 30 pounds no matter what I do right now. So that is kind of a problem. Good thing about that is really first and second gear, it can't actually make enough load to put that much boost down. So it kind of works out good. A single three-port got me 54 pounds. So I do have a second three-port that'll put pressure to the top, but I haven't had to use it yet. I might have to use it tomorrow if I want to go faster. So.
Okay, so there's no sort of secret that it's reasonably easy to make a lot of power with Honda engines. They are a very well-designed engine, particularly in the cylinder head department.
Yeah.
One of the challenges, though, is when you're making a lot of power, getting it to the ground reliably, and the gearbox is a weak point. So how have you addressed that? You mentioned a Dogbox earlier in our chat. Yep. What are you running there?
So this is actually a Graf. They're out of Argentina. It's a 5-speed Dogbox. So instead of your traditional 4-speed with a cuff and fifth gear, this has five gears, obviously. I'm shifting fifth pretty much right at the end of the quarter here. And so I'm in fifth gear all the way to almost, 10,600-700 RPMs here. And it's straight cut, Dogbox, nothing special. It's just custom ratios. And it all just works out for the car pretty well.
And with a Dogbox as well, one of the advantages, particularly for motorsport use, is that they can be shifted clutchless.
Yep.
And often you can incorporate a gear change ignition cut feature. You're doing that?
So I have a strain gauge on it. Right now I'm just logging how everything does before I actually set up the cut. So I'm just seeing how much I actually do. Do I keep my hand on it? So I'm watching all the voltage and the force that it has before I implement the gear shift cut. Right now I'm just full throttle clutch shifting. So, and it drops like 2 pounds on a shift.
And for those who aren't aware, the strain gauge is basically a gauge or a sensor on the gear lever that detects how much effort or load you're applying to it.
Correct.
So the ECU can then cut the ignition.
Exactly.
Okay, in terms of the engine management side of things, then obviously you've already mentioned that's quite critical. You've mentioned the safety features and the traction control. What is the ECU?
So it's a MoTeC M130 right now. I have an M150. I just haven't put it in there. Once I figured in the beginning, I was like, oh, I'm not going to need any more than 60 IOs and everything. I'll be fine. But we all, I got wastegate position sensors. I got shock plots I want to put on. So all these extra things that I have, that M130 is just not going to be enough. And it runs a John Reed Racing Honda package. And I've had it in there since the beginning of 2016. I was the first Honda package he had done. And it's super successful. I mean, John Reed puts everything that I need in there, and it all works. I mean, I can't argue. I loved it. Ever since then, I've just never looked back.
Now, in terms of actually looking at data from that MoTeC ECU, once you've performed a run here, where are you looking at that data? You've got a MoTeC dash in the car as well. Are you analyzing your data from the dash or from the M1 ECU itself?
Right now, it's all strictly from the M1 ECU. I did just unlock the IO, and I did unlock the loggings for it. So I will be using the dash. Right now, I just have a couple of safeties that are on the dash that'll display. Like if I over rev it, or if the coolant pressure was above, I'd say 25 pounds, longer than 500 milliseconds or something, it'll display it during the run. Other than that, it's a nice display. It shows me what's there. It has some nice shift lights, and that's about all it's using for.
I think probably it is overlooked, actually, that the real value with a high-powered, highly strung engine, having a user display there in the car. And let's be honest, when the car's doing everything it should do, you're not looking at it at all. All you're going to be doing is focusing on those shift lights. But as soon as something goes outside those user-defined parameters, oil pressure, coolant pressure, as you've mentioned, then it'll bring up a warning light. And that lets you know something's wrong, so you can then put your attention onto the dash. Now, I just want to focus on the pressure sensor that you just mentioned, coolant pressure.
Yeah.
So that's one that we see a lot in drag racing.
Yeah.
And can you just let us know why that's important?
So I learned the hard way about not having coolant pressure on a car. And, everyone was like, oh, you should do coolant pressure like 3 years ago. And I'm like, well, once it pushes, it's done, right? So what's the point? Well, perfect example is I actually torched the head, because it just basically breaches that and it turns into a torch out the head. So that's what happened. So torch the gasket, put a little thing in the head, and here I'm like, okay, I'm gonna do coolant pressure. So it runs a closed system, has a 32-pound cap on it, and it has no thermostat right now and just runs a factory Honda water pump on it. And at about 170, 180 degrees, it's about 12, 13 pounds. Runs there, it cools well enough to not have a problem. I know that if it hits anything above 24 or 5 pounds, it's breached the middle layer of the gasket. So my pressure, coolant pressure safety is set at 25, and if it sees that for longer than 500 milliseconds, it cuts the engine.
Okay, so again, for those who aren't sort of following this conversation, this is really comes down to, with a high power turbocharged engine, one of our real challenges is keeping the cylinder head sealed to the block. Yeah. And that's really often the limiting factor on how much boost and hence power we can make. So that coolant pressure sensor is detecting if the head gasket does start leaking.
Correct.
The combustion pressure makes its way into the cooling system. Yep. Hence it raises the pressure in the cooling system. So that's
exactly
what you're looking for there.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. Now, I just want to also talk about the fuel system that you're running on the car. So what fuel are you running? You mentioned an 11-to-1 or close to 11-to-1 compression. So sure as hell you're not running pump gas, particularly with that boost. What are you running there?
Yeah, so right now, beginning of the year, I switched it to M1 methanol. So it has 8 FIC 2150cc injectors in it, runs an 80-pound base with a mechanical pump, and then I have 2 Bosch 044s that feed a surge tank from a 5-gallon cell in the rear. So you got these 2 pumps feed the surge tank, and then the surge tank feeds the mechanical pump that's driven off the intake cam on the passenger side.
I think that's one of the things that's overlooked. Methanol is a great fuel for very high boost due to its cooling properties. But all things being equal, compared to pump gas, we need to use around about 2.5 times the volume of fuel to make the same power. So you do need a huge amount of fuel. So your choice on a mechanical pump over an EFI, sorry, electric pump, is it just you can't find an electric pump big enough?
I think you could, but you'd be running like 2 of them, then you'd have to run 16 volts to be able to power them to get that. And then in the end, it's just like, you know, I do drive the car on the street every once in a while, as dumb as I might be, but the mechanical pump, it's always what we've done. It takes load off the alternator too, so I still have an alternator in the car, and the mechanical pump just seemed like the logical idea.
Now, on that note as well, you've mentioned a 16-volt charging system or 16-volt battery, and this is something quite unique. We see a lot of drag cars ditch an alternator, ditch a charging system, and switch from a normal 12-volt battery to a 16-volt electrical system. Mm-hmm. You've gone a slightly different way, and this is something I've seen actually on a lot of the English racing cars.
I've never
seen it before. Can you tell us about your RC batteries?
Yeah, so basically, it just came down to all my guys have a lot of RC cars, and they have these really cool planes, and they have these 5S and 6S batteries, and he was just, TJ, like I said, the engine guy, is very smart guy, awesome guy there. He's like, well, why can't we just run the car on some of these batteries? So we tried it, and literally we've never looked back on any of our drag cars. They're literally a 16-volt China battery, and the problem is it doesn't have any LiPo cut like your standard batteries that you would buy that are 16-volt set up for cars. So, but like some of the cars have PDM, so we implement a cut, you know, 14.5 volts. But they're just literally, they are $75 each LiPo China batteries that we get that you would put in an RC car. And we have a charging setup for them. Each car has, the GTR runs 3 batteries actually, all in one. And every other car will run 2. This car actually has a 6S battery that powers, that's like a 20-volt boost a pump to the 044s. So that gives me a little bit more pressure, a little bit more voltage to those pumps. It can keep up with the demand of the little surge tank.
And obviously the 20-volt feed to these 044s hasn't hurt them?
Not yet. I mean, there's actually their 044s, their AM 044s. They came out with a new 400 or something that I put in last year, and they did flow more than your standard 044. And as of right now, I haven't heard them, yes.
And you need to charge the batteries between runs?
No. I mean, mine will pretty much go the whole weekend, because it's only activated when the second fuel pump comes on, which is via RPM. So it never sees that until that. So it'll actually go like 15, 20 passes before I actually need to charge it. The other cars, while they can go about, I would say they could go 2-3 passes before you have to charge them.
All right, look, Myles, really interesting to get some insight into what goes into this Honda. There's not too many Integras we've seen running 208 mile an hour in an event like this.
Yeah.
And considering that's your first real run here, you got the whole week ahead of you. Look, we wish you the best to go even faster again. Thanks, Myles.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Have you liked like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.